Friends, in the fifth module of the PG course in Visual Arts and Aesthetics for Indian sculpture, we are going to discuss the Shunga sculpture, mainly from Bharat. As you know, I am Deepak Kannal from Faculty of Fine Arts, MS University of Baroda. The purpose of this module is to introduce historical background, social as well as religious, that emerged during Shunga period. After this, Bharat sculpture is introduced and there is a discussion on various aspects of art. Shunga sculpture emerges as the first attempt towards creating a new language of art. The images are mostly of Buddhist affiliation, and independent religious structures called stupa emerged by that time. Buddhism brings a new philosophy and ideas with it, that is the Jatakas, Bodhisattva, Sangha, among others, which need to be understood in order to understand the art from this particular onwards. Brihadratha was the last Mauryan king who was assassinated by his commander-in-chief, Pushyamitra, who belonged to the Shunga family, and he became the first ruler of Shunga dynasty in 185 BCE. According to Harshacharita, Brihadratha was inspecting his troops when he was attacked. Shunga seem to have had conflict with Bactrian Greeks, and there are references to Yavanas. Foreigners in ancient India were called by this name, by Patanjali. Malavika Agnimitram, a play by Kalidasa, also talks about Agnimitra, who has been called the son of Pushyamitra. Shunga rulers lasted for 112 years, and 10 Shunga kings seem to have ruled during this period. According to Puranic literature, the last of these kings was Devabhuti or Devabhumi, who was taken over by Vasudeva, the Brahmana minister who conspired against the king. Vasudeva then founded the Kanva dynasty. Texts say that Pushyamitra performed the Vedic horse sacrifice, Ashwamedha, twice. This shows that he followed Vedic Brahmanical tradition and was not a Buddhist. Buddhist texts accuse him of killing Buddhists in order to revive Brahmanism. Even though works of art produced during the period of Shunga rule are known by that dynasty's name, it does not imply Shunga patronage. Sometimes even the place where that artwork is found may not have been under Shunga rule. This term is used only because kings ruling in those regions at that time are not known, and it is hard to tell who exactly patronized that work of art. Vidisha, a very important place in ancient India. Vidisha is the ancient name of the modern day Besnagar in north central India. It has been an important trade center since the time of Buddha on the southern trade route, Dakshinapatha, and connected Gangetic plains with western Indian coast. The city seems to have become extremely important during the rule of later Shungas, and a number of archaeological remains have been found around it. The most prominent among these is the Heliodorus pillar. The pillar has an inscription in Brahmi script which says that the pillar was a Garuda Dhvaja, that is standard, set up by Heliodorus from Takshashila, who was the ambassador of Greco-Bactrian king Antialcidas to king Bhagabhadra. The pillar has been set up in honor of Vasudeva. This means that a cult was prevalent which worshipped Vasudeva. A date bracket of 120 to 100 BCE has been suggested for this pillar. This pillar is half in size than a usual Ashokan pillar and has no polish. The pillar is not just circular but is divided into four unequal sections, has the Mauryan honeysuckle motif along with geese. The figure of a Garuda may have been on the top of the pillar. Another pillar capital has been found from Vidisha in the form of a banyan tree. There is no inscription on it, but on the basis of style, it can be dated to Shunga period. A basket-like form carved at the bottom of the tree seems to resemble the railings which were probably constructed around the sacred trees. Objects carved around the tree include coins, flowers, conch, shell, lotus, and a bag of riches. The tree probably presents the cult of nature worshippers. Freestanding Yaksha and Yakshi images have been found from Vidisha, but there is debate over their dating. Some scholars place them in Shunga period, while others place them in Mauryan period. These sculptures were not found from proper excavations, and therefore it is not possible to date them. They do not have Mauryan polish, but are otherwise stylistically slightly close to Mauryan images of Yaksha and Yakshi. One image from Vidisha of Kubera is almost 3 meters in height and is very monumental. The Yakshi image is smaller in comparison and is almost life size. The Parkham Yaksha discussed in the module on Mauryan art is also under much debate on its dating. Other centers of art which were active during this period apart from Vidisha were Mathura, Pataliputra, Ahichhatra, Ayodhya and Kaushambi. After Buddha attained the state of non-being or Mahaparinirvana at Kushinagar, according to Buddhist text, for some days his body was preserved in oil, after which it was cremated. 8 different kings claimed his relics, and to avoid a dispute, a Brahmin called Drona divided the relics into 8 parts and gave 1 part to each king. These 8 royal families were Ajatashatru, the king of Magadha, Mallas of Kushinagara, Lichhavis of Vaishali, Shakyas of Kapilavastu, Bulis Allakappa, Koliyas of Ramagrama, Mallas of Power, and Brahmin of Vedatipar. Stupas were built over these relics. Stupa is a funerary structure of Buddhist religion which consists of a central hemispherical structure which cannot be entered, and at the bottom center of which are buried the relics of Buddha or of a great Buddhist monk. This structure has an outer railing called Vedika and 4 gateways called Torana. Most of the sculptural depictions are found on the top of the Torana or on the Vedika, so that people circumambulating the central structure can look at them while doing so. Types of stupas will be rediscussed eventually in this module. Redistribution of these 8 parts of Buddha's relics has been claimed by texts. It is said that Ashoka of Mauryan Empire redistributed these relics into many more parts and built stupa over them. Many relics cascades have been recovered in excavations. Buddha has also wished that Buddhist councils must be held after he was no more, where discussions could take place. The 3rd Buddhist council seemed to have been held under the directions of Ashoka. A stupa can be of different types. The most important of them is the Sharira stupa, where the actual relics of Buddha himself are kept. There are very few such stupas, and some texts claim that Ashoka redistributed these relics into 34 parts and built stupas over them. Other texts claim that the relics redistributed into an unrealistic number of 84,000. However, a list of places is also available where these relics are supposed to have been buried by Ashoka. But many places have not been identified. Yet, relics have been found from places called Devniwari. But this place is not mentioned in the list. Probably the names of the place changed over time. Another kind of stupa is that which has objects used by Buddha or any other great Buddhist monk. It could be their stick, the bowl, the footwear, or anything else. This kind of stupa is called Paribhogika stupa, a stupa which does not have any relics called abortive stupa or uddeshika stupa. For example, most of the stupas carved in the caves are votive stupas. Bharut lies in the north central India and has the remains of a large stupa. The stupa has been almost destroyed over time and its parts are scattered in various museums. A major section of it are in the Indian Museum, Calcutta. There are various inscriptions on this stupa which show that parts of it were donated by merchants and laypersons. Bharut was located on a trade route, and that must have played an important role in the handsome donations. The central hemispherical structure was made of bricks, while the railing, Vedika, was made in stone. The stupa has extraordinarily carved gateway called Toranas. The sculptures on the Vedika and Torana can be dated to 100 to 80 BCE, though it has been speculated that central structure may have been built earlier. It was a common practice to make addition to an existing structure at a later stage. This stupa is more ornamented than the one at Sanchi, and motifs on it include Gajalakshmi, an elephant rider carrying the relic cast of his in his right hand, his companion holding a pillar standard, Greek warrior, and Naga kings. The Naga king has an inscription along with in which says Chakavaka, king of Nagas. The cult of serpent worship seems to have been very strong in ancient India, and traces of it are seen even today in different parts of the country. Yaksha and Yaksha images too are found in a significant number of showing that cult still had a very strong grounding with people. A Yakshi image called Yakshini Chandra stands on top of a horse-headed, makara-tailed animal and is holding the branch of Ashoka tree, and therefore she is called Ashoka Dohada. Many faces of portraits are seen emerging from a lotus flower on the stupa, but due to the absence of any inscription, it is not possible to say who these people may have been. Apart from these various scenes from life of Buddha and stories from his previous births, that is Jatakas, have been depicted. In his previous birth, Buddha was born as a human as well as animals. There is considerable debate on the absence of human depiction of Buddha in this place. The accepted understanding is that in the early phase of Buddhism called Hinayana, human depiction of Buddha was not permitted by religion, and therefore an iconic representation is preferred. Human depiction of Buddha appear in the next phase called Mahayana. The depiction of Bharut mentioned many donors, which prove that laypersons and merchant community has a big role to play, as patrons and royal patronage did not really play an important role. Even though many inscriptions say that a pillar is made during the reign of Shungas, it does not imply their patronage. Two inscriptions from Bharut are as follows. Within the dominion of the Shungas, the gateway has been caused to be made, and the workmanship in stone produced by Vasitiputta Dhanabhuti, son of Gotiputta Agaraju, and grandson of King Gargiputra Vishwadeva. This inscription has been discussed in this module. Another inscription reads, first pillar to gift of Chapadevi, the wife of Revati Mitra, a lady from Vidisha. The Jataka tales, stories of previous lives of Buddha, can debatably be said to contain elements of the earlier folklore available to us today. In his previous births, Buddha appears as a human or animal, but performs deeds or actions which make him a potential future Buddha. The story thus preaches good conduct in life as being the Buddhist way of life. Tripitaka, the Buddhist text, devote a small section to Jataka. Pali canon or the Pali version consists of around 550 Jatakas, and the origin of many of these stories seem to be non-Buddhist. They may have been derived from Panchatantra or other animal fables. E.B. Cowell is one of the scholars who have worked extensively on Jatakas, and translations are available. Buddha Ghosha was probably the compiler of these Jatakas, and his date can be estimated around 5th century. Buddha Ghosha was an important scholar of his time and wrote other texts as well. The Sanskrit version of Jataka is known as Jataka Mala, and 34 Jatakas have been compiled in this version. Mahavastu is another compilation which has 80 Jatakas. This was probably the oldest of all and may be dated 1st to 2nd century BCE. Some Jatakas are as follows. Vidura Pandita Jataka is one in which a Yaksha called Punnaka, Prakrit for Purnaka, falls in love with a princess. In order to seek permission to marry her, he goes to her father, who demands the minister of the neighboring kingdom called Vidura Pandita, who is known for his wisdom. The Yaksha wins the Vidura Pandita over a game of dice, and on his way back, he tries to kill the Pandita and hangs him upside down. But the Pandit tells him that if Punaka kills him, his purpose would be defeated. Thus, Vidura Pandita reaches the king and teaches him important lessons, and the king finally decides to return the Pandita. Vesantara Jataka is the story in which Bodhisattva is born as a prince Vesantara, who gives away everything that was asked for him. Eventually, he ends up giving away the precious white elephant of his kingdom that is responsible for bringing rains. He is banished to the forest for this by his father, and there he gives away his children and wife as well. According to Chaddanta Jataka, the Bodhisattva was once born as an elephant with 6 tusks. The elephant had 2 wives, and the younger one gets extremely angry because once ignorance while playing, the elephant shook a tree. Flowers fell on the head of the elder wife, and the thorns and twigs fell on the younger one. She immediately jumped off a cliff and died. She was reborn as the queen, and on the pretext of being pregnant, desired the task of that particular elephant, tusks of that particular elephant. Different versions of the story tell different ways in which the elephant himself gives his tusks away to the hunter sent by the king. In one, he allows the hunter to take, and in order to help the hunter in cutting it, and dies. Seeing the tusk, the queen realizes that he is no more. She faints and dies as well. This Jataka is depicted at Bharut and various other places, including Ajanta murals and Amravati. In one Jataka called Mahakapi Jataka, which is depicted on the stupa, Buddha is born as the monkey king of 80,000 monkeys. Once a human king attacks their forest in search of a famous mango tree. In order to help other monkeys escape, Bodhisattva acts as a bridge between 2 trees on opposite side of a river. The last monkey to cross this bridge is Devadatta, Buddha's evil cousin, who stomps on his back and breaks it. The human king sees this and is impressed by the monkey king and cares for him. The monkey king then teaches the human king good conduct and virtue. In another depiction, we see Sankasya, that is believed to be the place where Buddha seemed to have descended from Tushita heaven, using a ladder, where he has gone to preach to his deceased mother. Indra and Brahma too seem to have accompanied him. This place probably became a religious site during modern time, and there is a depiction of it on Bharut Stupa. 1 foot of Buddha is shown on the topmost level of the ladder, while the other is seen at the bottommost. This indeed is a unique way devised by the artist to communicate the narrative. Buddha was once invited by Ananta Pendekar to stay at Shravasti, who bought a park belonging to Jetakumara so that Buddha could stay there with his Sangha. The price paid for this park was the entire park was covered with gold. This particular incident also finds depiction on Bharut Stupa. Stories of Buddha's life can be found in texts like Nidana Katha. Even though the Indian subcontinent has witnessed Indus Valley sculpture, terracotta images from post-Harappa and pre-Mauryan times and Mauryan sculpture, as yet, a definite grammar or language of Indian sculpture is yet to emerge. In Shunga sculpture, we see that there is an attempt at developing a language. Shunga sculpture is not made by or made for the royal. The intention is to communicate to common people and to make sculpture which people can understand. Scholars like Dhuler, Vidya Dahejia and others have suggested different dates for the sculpture, but they do not speak about the evolution of sculpture. Style has not been used to date images by them. Yaksha and Yakshi sculptures on the stupa are not freestanding and are almost embedded in the stone. They are almost flattened. The hands of the Yakshis are pressed along with the body, and even the feet are made to turn in profile so that they can be made along with the flat surface. This can almost be called a feature of Bharut sculpture. The voluptuousness of Kushana figures, which will be seen later, is not seen in these images. The female images appear heavy, dense, and grounded. In most of these cases, we find an inscription along with the image, probably because there is no fixed iconography that has developed until this time. Inscriptions appear even in case of Prasenajit and Ajatashatru pillar. The idea of a Yakshi, however, is fully conveyed as she is seen almost hugging a tree, which shows she is associated with fertility. It is also mentioned in Kama Sutra that a sala tree blossoms only when a beautiful lady kicks it or pukes wine on its roots. The pose of the Yakshi, in which she holds the branch of the tree, gives the name of Shalabhanjika. Various other Yakshis have been depicted, like Sirima Devata, Chulakoka Devata, who stand on the elephant and is holding the bow of a tree. Mahakoka Devata, Sudarshana Devata. Dhanabhuti inscription written in Kharoshti, which mentions Dhanabhuti as the donor of the pillar, does not mention the name of Shunga king, Agnimitra or Pushyamitra, who were extremely important rulers of their times. It is probable that Dhanabhuti inscription is a post-Agnimitra inscription, and thus, along with this inscription, Chandra Yakshi and Ajatashatru sculpture were probably made in the last phase of stupa, which may be the late Shunga period. The dating of the different sculptures of Bharut has been a subject of debate among scholars, and different scholars have diverse opinions about it. In the narrative sculptures of Bharut, which mostly depict either episodes from the life of Buddha or Jatakas for the first time in Indian sculpture, the artist attempt to narrate a story visually. There is no horizon or perspective, and images are placed on top of one another. The main idea of the image is to convey the story and not to depict the idea of space. The sculptor literally coins a pictorial language which did not exist before. His language is not influenced by an external tradition like in case of Mauryan royal sculpture. The figures seen, as seen previously with Yakshi images, are flattened. In some depictions, the artist tries to show everything within a single depiction. This can be understood as iconic depiction. It usually consists of the most important scene in the story, and that very instance becomes a representative of the entire story. Since people are already familiar with the story, this one most important scene is able to remind them of the entire story, and thus the message is conveyed. In other depictions, we even see the protagonist more than once in order to tell the story. In some cases of narrative, is shown in different phases. One thing to be noted is that this phase, Buddha is not depicted as a human being, and some symbols are used to show his presence. Very often, his footprints. For example, a unique device is created by artist to show the episode when Buddha goes to Tushita Heaven, the 33rd heaven, to preach Buddhism to his mother. 33 steps have been shown in the ladder used by Buddha. As mentioned earlier, his one foot is shown on top and the other foot is shown at the bottom. This kind of language adopted in Bharat sculpture is the first stage of the complex language that emerges in Indian sculpture later. The depictions here are not metaphorical, they are obvious, and as first attempts are extremely unique. It is interesting to note here that early Sanchi, the Hinayana phase of Ajanta phase, Kondane and Pitalkhora caves in Western Deccan, Amaravati and Bharud, all are contemporary to each other. We will look at these art traditions in the coming modules.